Good evening. Once again, coming to you from beautiful downtown York, in the middle of York, Pennsylvania, it's Free Thought Forum Live. Tonight is a live call-in show, as you are well aware, and this means that we would like to see a few viewers call in, give us their opinions, ask questions if necessary. We'll try to vary the subject, so there's a little bit here for everyone. And if you would like to call up and to change a subject, something you'd like to talk about, please feel free to do so. The number will appear shortly. Well, that was pretty shortly on your screen. There, kindly note that the number is preceded by a star. That's the lower left-hand button on your telephone pad. Star 82, 717-846-5067. And if your fingers don't fall off from pushing all the buttons, you will get through to us. Please remember, though, that this show is on a 7-second time delay, which means that after you speak into your telephone, before you hear it on your television or on your computer, if you're watching on the computer, there will be 7 seconds going by, so you really should turn the volume down on your computer or on your television set so it does not become confusing. Looks like we do have a call, and if the person that is on the telephone would like to intercept that, thank you. Didn't even get a chance to get it out of our mouths.
Yeah.
Obviously. Yeah, I know.
Well, we've got must have an interesting show.
No, I hope
we've got
so.
People calling already. Let's see.
No. Oh.
Well, that was a hang-up. He was probably trying to order a pizza and got the wrong number.
Yeah. With extra toppings here. So anyway, like I said, this is a live call-in show. Be sure to turn your television or your computer volume down, because if you don't, you get a heck of a sort of echo, a 7-second delay, and you'll never know whether or not you're on.
You'll know in 7 seconds. You'll know that you've messed up, and you're talking and saying, "Are you there? Are you there?" And,
well,
we're answering.
You know, I'm rambling on here, and I should have done the introductions. Hey, I'm Doug Diggins, often referred to as Dastardly Doug. I'm your host for the evening, and my co-host this evening is George Serber.
Yes.
And we'd like to thank you for tuning in. It looks like we've got another call. And
another pizza request.
Pizza request, or maybe it's a calzone. I don't know.
This is Jim. Hi.
It sounds like a personal call
like
to me.
Really somebody's calling in now.
Okay.
Well,
go ahead.
Go on. We're going to have some callers tonight. So.
See you at the poll.
Oh, we've got an important topic to talk about here, and our caller has a lot of information about it. And he'll be here in just a second.
Okay. Oh. Dastardly Carl.
Carl, you there?
Hello there, Dastardly Carl. How are you?
Hello, Dastardly Doug and George. How are you doing?
Okay.
Pretty good. Oh, and it says here.
Remember.
He says possible hostile callers.
Well, I think our producer wants us to do the disclaimer. Remember, anything you hear here, don't blame the TV station. It's all our fault.
That's it in a nutshell.
There you go.
They don't sponsor us. They don't endorse us.
They don't even like us.
No, they don't even like us. They just give us free speech here, and so don't go making phone calls saying, why are you putting it on? Because the station is not putting this program on. We're snuck in the back door and we fired up the equipment.
But Carl's got something interesting to tell us about right here in central Pennsylvania, don't you, Carl?
Yeah, we were contacted, that is, PA Nonbelievers was contacted Saturday morning by a parent who has two young children in the Northern Lebanon School District. It's near Annville, about a half hour east of Harrisburg.
Yeah.
And they have several elementary schools there, and one of the elementary schools is called East Hanover Elementary. And apparently this parent, this father's first grader, on Friday brought home a flyer, and he told us that the flyer was delivered to all children in the school via their mailboxes. And here is what the flyer said. It said, "See you at the poll day, Wednesday, September 28th. Now, before I continue with this, I'll tell you, for people who aren't aware, that See You at the Poll Day is an annual event, a Christian event, where, in theory, kids, on their own initiative, go out to the flagpole, usually before school. Actually, some churches now are actually holding the events on church property on the weekend before the See You at the Poll Day, and are having them pray for their schools at church, which is fine. That's where it should happen. But anyway, this particular one this year is Wednesday, September 28th, and this flyer said, "See You at the Poll is a global day of prayer for our schools at a designated time in front of the flagpole. This event is simply a day where students and parents can come to gather as one, standing side by side, to pray for our children, our families, our school, and our community. As a parent of an East Hanover student, I would like to invite all of our students and their families to participate on Wednesday, September 28th at 8:50. Now, you got to remember these times, 8:50 a.m., at the East Hanover Elementary School flagpole to take part in this event. If your child would like to be part of this 10-minute activity, we can't wait to see them at the flagpole. If this is something you would not like your child to participate in, please sign the bottom of this paper and return to your child's teacher by Tuesday, September 27th, and that's today. And then it's signed, "Thank you," and then a name of a woman who identifies herself as a parent volunteer. And then there's a line that says, "I do not want my child to participate in this event," and there's space for a signature. Mm-hmm. Now, the father who reported this to us said, "You know, this event makes me angry because it is taking academic time from my child." So, what we did was we looked up on their website of the school district to find out exactly what the hours of this school are. And it turns out that they'd opened the doors to the school at 8:40, and the school day actually begins at 8:50, which is the same time that they plan to have this prayer event. Mm-hmm. Well, as I was alluding to earlier, this See You at the Poll concept is popular at many, many, many schools around the country.
It's not global.
Well, it may not be global, but it's pretty widespread across the U.S.
Yeah.
And it's mainly geared to secondary school students. A couple of reasons for that. I mean, there usually aren't a whole lot of elementary school kids who are going to initiate a program like this. And in order for it to be constitutional, it really needs to be student-initiated. And it needs to have no involvement by the school district at all. And it can't be during the time that the kids are supposed to be in class.
Right.
Now, there's a law called the Equal Access Act that applies only to secondary schools. And what that says is that, by the way, I'm hearing some clicking on the line here, so if I lose you, I will try to call you back.
Okay, good.
But anyway, this Equal Access Act for secondary schools says that, you know, if there's a period during the day when the kids can have club meetings or go to the library, sort of like a free-for-all kind of a period, they can go and pray. They can go in groups and pray. They can have a Bible club and pray. There's not a problem with that. But they can't really have any kind of active involvement by the teachers or the staff. Now, they might have to be a monitor in the room to make sure the kids don't destroy the room or, you know, have an animal sacrifice in the room or something like that. But again, that's for secondary school kids. And the courts have made a big distinction between, you know, secondary kids who are sort of more independent, more thinking for themselves, and able to understand that something that goes on in the school doesn't necessarily mean that the school thinks it's great or the school endorses it. The distinction is elementary kids are very impressionable, and they usually wouldn't really know that an activity that's taking place during the school day on school property isn't something that the government, that the school district, endorses and approves of. So this school district not only set this up so unconstitutionally by doing it during the school day, beginning at 8:50, but they also required this cockamamie opt-out permission slip. So essentially what's happening is, I imagine what would happen is the kids get off the bus, and you know why they schedule it at 8:50? Why, you know, why didn't they just schedule it originally at 8:40 or 8:30 or 8:15? That would be less rushed. Mm-hmm. You know, they could do more prayers. We all know that their prayers work, so they could pray three times as long and have three times the effect, right? Okay?
Yes.
But why did they choose to do it at 8:50? Well, it's clear. Because they don't want to have to inconvenience the parents to have to bring the kids early. They want the school buses to bring the kids to the prayer event at the school. So they were, and apparently they've been getting away with this for years. The secretary to the school board reported that this has been going on for years and that it meets all the legal requirements. And that no teachers are outside of the school building while this event is going on.
Hmm.
So wait a minute here. The flagpole is a few feet from the highway. The kids are outside during the school day.
Unsupervised
by teachers, at least. I mean, you know, I don't know whether other paid staffers are out there, you know, supporting prayer under government time. But at least there aren't any teachers out there. And the other question is, okay, so these kids arrive, and we learned that the buses arrive between 8:43 and 8:48, typically. Okay? So they only have from 8:43... you know, till the event begins at 8:50, right?
Right.
Or maybe even 8:48 to 8:50. So about two to seven minutes to get out to the flagpole. So I imagine what happens, although we don't know for sure, is that as the kids get off the bus, there's sort of like a Nazi-like sorter out there as the trains arrived.
Yeah.
With all of the the Jews, you know, the sorter is there to send people to the left to pray, or to the right to the gas chamber, okay, or in this case the classroom. And then the other thing is that if you're doing this as an opt-out, and, well, first of all, what if the parent, the thing was only distributed on Friday. Yeah. What if the parent didn't notice this thing?
Well, the kids didn't deliver it. That happens. Kids forget things. You know?
That's right. That happens a lot. Yeah. So if the kids forget it and they go to school without having submitted this opt-out, are they forced to go out there and pray?
Yeah, that was my question.
Yeah, they didn't opt out.
Yeah. And then the other thing is that let's just suppose the parent did see the form, the parent signs the form, the form is supposed to go back to the school teacher, Now, wait a minute. If the school's not involved with this, why is a school teacher involved with this? And if it goes to the school teacher, does it get passed on to the Christian organizers so they can keep a little list of who the non-praying heathen kids are in the community? You know?
Yeah.
Or does the school keep that list? Or how about this? If they release the list or these permission slips to the Christian organizers, isn't that a violation of student confidentiality, which they're so careful about nowadays in public schools?
Yeah.
And one of our directors, Jason, brought up a good point earlier today, and that's that this event, or at least the aftermath of this event, could have the effect of bullying non-believing kids, and the schools are heavily into this anti-bullying.
Yes.
Yeah.
Promotion of being against bullying, which is good, because I mean, I was bullied as a kid, many of us were, but if this kid comes back with his form and other kids learn that this kid did not go out to pray, is there going to be bullying as a result? Who's going to be responsible? Who should be held personally responsible for any kind of injury or harassment that this gentleman's kids might endure because of this praying during school time?
Yeah, and I mean, let's face it, the kids will jump on the bandwagon the first chance that they get. Oh, he didn't pray. You know, like, let's beat him up, right?
Well, you're all know children are cruel to other children.
Absolutely.
Carl, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Did the president of Pennsylvania Nonbelievers send a letter?
I don't know. Who is the president of Pennsylvania Nonbelievers?
Well, it happens to be me.
Oh, it's you. So can you answer your own question?
No, I can't, because I didn't have the letter.
Oh,
unfortunately,
okay.
I was at work.
But you gave us the okay to
yes,
send it.
Yes, I did.
The answer
did
is yes.
Okay, I did send a letter. Okay.
Sent this morning.
Good.
And for the viewers, I will tell the viewers who would not know that we contacted Americans United for Separation of Church and State. We contacted the Freedom From Religion Foundation. We contacted American Atheists. The parent contacted the ACLU, although we don't really know if they're at all involved in this at this point. They operate a little slower because this might strike close to home, but they have a lot of committees that projects have to be approved by and get approval from their board before the ACLU can take on a new project. So anyway, but Freedom From Religion and those other groups did respond very quickly by afternoon yesterday and sent letters to the solicitor, the attorney for the school board, to the superintendent, who was actually out of the office, sort of,
mm-hmm.
Through October 3rd. And also some of the agencies sent it to the principal also. And basically, we explained the law to these people who should already know the law. They should already know this law. By the way, that's the travesty of this whole thing, is that obviously for years and years, this has been going on during the school day, and the solicitor probably has known about it. The superintendent and the principal surely would have known about it, as would all of the teachers in those buildings. And, I mean, we don't really know whether it's been in all the buildings or not, but we'll assume, but at least in this one elementary school. And the teachers never ratted on this unconstitutional activity. They never did. They should know the law, or they should at least question it, and they could have gone to their union, they could have gone to any of the organizations we went to. They could have probably even gone to Pat Robertson's attorney, Jay Sekulo of the American Center of Law and Justice. Now, I don't want to speak for him, but I have heard him speak, and I'm pretty sure I've heard him be very much against elementary school kids supposedly doing these kind of events. He I don't think they defend a whole lot of elementary school kids doing this kind of stuff. And I'm almost certain they don't defend it if it's happening during the school day. So what happened was, these letters arrived at the solicitor and the superintendent's office. And of course, the secretary to the superintendent admitted that it had been going on for years, and it, you know, it wasn't violating the law, and the teachers weren't out there, and so forth, so on. When they got the letter from these organizations, you know, we didn't hear from them overnight, obviously. But this morning I called the Lebanon newspaper, and it was really interesting because they were already aware of the issue. Apparently, it had been talked about on radio sometime yesterday. And also, the parent apparently had called into a radio show. I think it was a different show. But so the newspaper was already aware of the problem. They didn't know all the details. But they had heard this morning that there might be a cancellation due to bad weather tomorrow. Oh, how convenient. And somebody said, yeah, bad weather, an unexpected firestorm. So about a half an hour after I talked to that reporter, that editor, we got the parent talked to the principal. And here is what, if I can find it here, bear with me a second. Here is what, let's see if I can find it, what the principal said to the parent.
Carl, yeah. While you're looking for that, I think I should point out Americans United against for the separation of church and state is headed by the Reverend Barry Lynn. So this
exactly.
Also religious people find this offensive.
Exactly. And I will tell you that this gentleman, this father, does not classify himself as an atheist. He says his religious beliefs are personal, and he doesn't discuss them with anyone. Okay, so it's not like he's this flaming activist atheist, like we are, or some of us are. Anyway. So the parent emailed and said, "I just got off the phone with the principal." She said the event has been moved to 8:40 a.m. And by the way, I talked to him later, and she specifically said it had been moved to 8:40 a.m. She has not produced or distributed any information about the time change because she was ordered not to do so.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yes, obviously ordered by the lawyer.
Yeah.
Okay. Buses will arrive at normal times at 8:43 to 8:48.
Mm-hmm.
Interested families will already be at the poll. But well, now wait a minute. How did the interested families find out about the change in time? If the other families didn't find out, how did the interested families find out? Okay, how do they know who's interested or not?
You must have a list, an interest list and a non-interest list.
Yeah, I mean, did they get these permission slips today? And anybody who didn't bring back a permission slip got a phone call. You know, maybe was it done so there was no paper trail on this? Okay, so interested families will already be at the poll. The father says, I asked if kids on the bus would be participating, and she was evasive. Kind of depends on what time the buses arrive. Overall, she was somewhat evasive. Made me think someone is trying to pull a fast one. No admission of wrongdoing or misguided decision making. I pressed her on that a little. Anyway, so, you know, this news comes in. Now it has been moved to 8:40 a.m. Following me so far?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. About a half hour later, I get a letter, and several of us got this letter. It was distributed to all of the involved organizations.
All the troublemakers, yeah.
Yeah, all the troublemakers. This was from the attorney at the Freedom From Religion Foundation, which was the first, it was either the first or the second agency to actually send a letter yesterday to try to stop this event. And the letter is from the attorney with the school board. And the attorney says the following. To the attorney, thank you for your letter of last evening. As a result of your interest, We inquired about the See You at the Pole event at the East Hanover Elementary School. We found that the facts are materially different than those advanced in your letter. Specifically, number one, the See You at the Pole event is, has been, and remains parent/student initiated. Okay, you know, I think it's supposed to be student initiated, but okay, we'll let that one pass for the moment. Number two, the instructional day of the school begins at 8:50 a.m. Okay, we agree on that.
Mm-hmm.
The event will commence at 8:40 a.m. and will be concluded by 8:50 a.m. Thus, the event will not occur during the instructional day. Okay, hang on here. You know, again, if this is the way they've done it all these years, why did they, on their form, and they absolutely said on the form, we have a photo of the form, said that the event will be at 8:50 a.m. Yeah, you normally don't give the time that an event concludes.
Yeah, that's
you know?
Right. Yeah.
You give the time that you need to be at the event,
yes,
at 8:50. Then it says, number three, the program will be led by students and not by school district personnel. Okay, well, okay, maybe, but why didn't a student draft the letter for permission that was going to be distributed? Number four, the event will not take place in the school building. Instead, the event will occur outside of the building at the school's flagpole. Well,
but still on
we never claimed it was going to be in the school building. Okay, we never claimed that. And on the form, it clearly says, you know, come to the flagpole. You know, we're coming to the flagpole. Now, and then he concludes, he says, based upon our review of this matter, we have concluded that the conclusions and presumptions articulated in your letter are inapplicable. Thank you for your interest. Now, it's interesting that this particular attorney, if you look up his biography, is a graduate of Grove City College.
Oh, we know what that is, don't we?
Yeah, you want to tell people about Grove City College? It's a very fundamentalist school where they have all kinds of rules. Like, I don't want to over-exaggerate, but like, you can't walk on the lawns, and maybe you can't even hold hands with somebody of the opposite sex. It's sort of like on the on par with like Bob Jones University, that kind
the
of
opposite. How about the same sex?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
hold hands with
them. Really out.
Yeah, you can hold hands with somebody of the same sex. No, there. So that's where really the matter stands right now, and so apparently this event is going to happen. It'll be interesting to see whether the buses arrive unusually early.
Yes, that's what I was thinking about.
So we will have observers there, and if any of you guys want to join us, please do. And there will be reporters there, we do know that the Patriot News was already working on a See You at the Pole story. And it's my understanding that all of the other schools that were interviewed about See You at the Pole have the event before school hours. Okay. And apparently there are some elementary schools that do this. But again, the impression the reporter conveyed to me was that it's done well before the beginning of school. Obviously what we have here, is when this principal was ordered not to put anything in writing about the change in the time, is they didn't want to have any evidence that the time indeed changed, that it wasn't, you know, but obviously the evidence is there on the form. The evidence is there on the form. So we either have a cover-up, an attempt at a cover-up, or tremendous incompetence and tremendous ignorance of the law.
Yeah.
Or unconcerned about the law. If you're getting away with something,
right,
it doesn't matter, does it?
Right.
I was thinking, Carl, about the school buses possibly getting there early. Does that mean the bus drivers will be hurrying along, rushing?
I was thinking, you know, if we really wanted to throw a monkey wrench in the works, we could get a dozen people out there with cars on the road, yeah, and we can get in front of the school buses, and our cars would break down for a few minutes. You know?
Oh, we're not that devious, are we?
Well, you know, they're devious.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
I'm one to fight fire with fire, and... as a matter of fact, there was just an email that came through from Freedom From Religion about all of the problems they're having with the Gideons coming into the schools.
Oh.
And I think I probably told this, I know I've told the story to you guys, but I may have mentioned it at a time in the past on this TV show, that I had a problem many years ago with the Gideons coming to my school district down in Franklin County. And the way we got it fixed was to demand to distribute a booklet called God Is Just Pretend.
Oh, yes, one of our favorites. Yeah.
Yes. So I think they ought to resurrect God Is Just Pretend and really start fighting fire with fire, because I really think that often works a lot better than just, you know, sort of being nice and asking politely and all this kind of stuff.
Well, don't we still have some of those booklets around?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. We, I mean, these are not masterpieces of literature.
Should we take some of them up to Lebanon tomorrow?
I will see. That is a good point. That is a good point. Thank you. Thank you for reminding me. Do you have any questions or ideas regarding this that we want to discuss on the air?
Well, we got legal people working on it. That's good. We'll see what those other organizations want to do.
Yeah, we were sort of hoping that, you know, this would be sort of clear-cut and we would be able to file an emergency injunction to stop the event. But it's hard to do with such little time.
Yeah.
And I do think one thing that you might be interested in is the legal standard that would be required for an injunction to be issued. And I have that here, I think, if I can find it. I'm sorry if I can't find it here. I might have lost it. Here we go. So, you know, if something's happening and you want to stop it before it happens, here's what, at least in one part of the country, the federal court system, one part of the country, here's the factors that the court has to consider if you want to stop an event before it happens. Number one, the likelihood of irreparable harm to the plaintiff if the preliminary injunction is denied.
Mm-hmm.
Two, the likelihood of harm to the defendant if the requested relief is granted. Number three, the likelihood that the plaintiff will succeed on the merits of the case. I mean, does the case have value? Would they win if it went to a full-blown hearing? And then number four, the public interest. So when you look back at that, I mean, I think this would be a very clear-cut case if we had attempted an injunction. I mean, the likelihood of harm, you have these impressionable young kids being singled out or having to stay home to avoid this second-class citizen kind of atmosphere, to avoid having them exposed to an environment where they could perceive that their school endorses praying, okay? The likelihood of harm to the defendant, to the school district, if the requested relief is granted, tell me what kind of harm would come to them if they are prevented from allowing this event.
They could just schedule it again another day after we resolve this.
Well, they could try.
Yeah,
they could try.
Yeah.
But I mean, this would. They could schedule it at an earlier time, way before the school hour, and have kids initiate it and all that,
right,
and do it the right way. You're right. They could do that way. The likelihood that the plaintiff would succeed on the merits, all those legal agencies feel that it's a good case. And then the public interest. Now, here's where the public interest, is it the public interest of the majority, the Christians, or the public interest of the hated minority? So, who's to say what the public interest is?
Well, that's interesting. So it's going to go off tomorrow, right?
Apparently so. And if it's really heavy rain, it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Yes. Yeah. Well, wait a minute, though. I thought they believe in a supreme being. Doesn't he watch out for them?
Can't they pray for no rain?
Yeah. Well, you know, God has a plan.
He does.
Yeah.
It's just not clear to us, is it?
Yeah, but, you know, God has a plan, but then they want to pray to try to change God's mind.
Well, I never understood that anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, because I know, you know, people that have a 30-day planner or a 5-week planner, they get upset if you ask them to change one little thing on it, you know?
That's right.
And you're asking God to change eternity, you know, because all this stuff affects everything else. You know?
Yeah, can you imagine God and his having his BlackBerry and getting all these requests to change his calendar and all of this stuff, you know?
Yeah, he's got to be ticked off at that. He might send another flood, you know?
That's right. It's interesting that area, you know, Lebanon County got hit very, very hard with the flooding. And now with the rain today and maybe tomorrow, you know.
Maybe God's trying to tell us something.
Maybe God's trying to stop this prayer of it.
Yeah. But he's on our side, you mean? Just like the Reverend Barry Lynn is.
That's right. God, if God exists, he could very well be on our side.
Yeah.
Because he might be very angry at all of these arrogant religionists who think they know what God wants.
Yes.
Well, God's been angry for quite some time, so.
Well, judging from the earthquakes and the tsunamis and floods and everything else, yeah.
Yeah.
I'd say if he's out there, he's pretty angry.
And satellites falling out of the sky. I mean,
fortunately, that didn't kill anyone, did it?
You know, the other thing is that, you know, God's son, Jesus, you know, the PR campaign by the Christian industry, seems to want to portray Jesus. By the way, I'm looking at you on the internet here, George.
Yes.
And you know, you'd make a great Jesus.
You think so?
Yeah, all right. He looks just like one painting.
Yeah, marching in a parade. I think don't you think George would make a great Jesus marching in a parade? We'll talk to you about that.
You're trying to line me up, aren't you? He's trying to get me out there in that parade.
Yeah, I am trying to get you out there.
There's a painting. Of Jesus that is it's a dead ringer for George.
Or George
Collins. Yes, I know. Absolutely dead ringer. And that's why he would make it so good, and especially if we're going to have him as a zombie Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, we just have to make him a little paler and, you know, have some blood running out of his mouth.
Well, I can't get much paler, can I?
Well, I mean...
But anyway, what I was getting at about Jesus is the Christian industry wants to portray Jesus as this nice guy, as this really loving, nice guy. But, you know, I've really thought about it, and you know, I used to buy into that. I used to say, you know, if everybody was like Jesus, what a great world this would be. But they don't stop to think that how can somebody who condemns anybody, even a murderer, but even less, is an adulterer or a thief, anybody, if it condemns anybody to unspeakable torment for eternity...
Yeah, not just for a week or so, but eternity.
I mean, Jesus was worse than Hitler. I mean, Hitler, you know, tortured and tormented people for, you know, months, maybe a year or two, maybe just a few hours. And then they were dead. You know, at least Jesus got it over. I mean, at least Hitler got it over with.
Yeah.
With Jesus, he can't get enough. He can't get enough.
And he'll sit on the rim of hell laughing at you as you suffer.
Exactly. And I really, we're sort of laughing about this, but I really seriously think that atheists need to remind Christians of this. And don't let them get away with what a nice guy Jesus was or is.
Mm-hmm. Will be.
Well, you know, their belief, though, is that, well, if you just believe, you do everything he says, you'll be okay.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's a terrorist.
Yeah,
you know?
that is.
Bin Laden wanted us to get out of Israel, I mean, you know, to get Israel out of the Middle East and to get out of the oil fields, out of Saudi Arabia, or he would, you know, take it out on the American public, and that's what he did.
That's
the same as Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you can't, you literally, even in heaven, you have to kiss his butt every single day for all eternity. Because you can't tell that once you've made it to heaven, you know, that he isn't going to change his mind.
Right, right.
Well, I thought once you're in, you're in. No, what? You mean you can get kicked out?
Well, I, you know, what happens if you have a little self-determination, you know, and he says, you know, God says, hey, I'd like you to kiss my left cheek today. And I go, oh, no, I'd prefer the right, like that.
Well, I didn't see, I haven't studied the Bible that much. I guess I missed that kind of thing.
You can find really anything you want, any excuse in, okay. In the thing.
I'll try to remember that when I need an excuse for my wife who's sitting back there.
Yeah, well, George, remember, you haven't read the Bible very much. Well, neither have most Christians.
That's true.
And if they read the Bible, they leave Christianity, many of them anyway.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, I think I ought to hang up to allow some other callers, hopefully, to call in and maybe discuss what we've talked about here.
Yeah,
or condemn us to hell.
condemn you to hell.
That's happened many times. Yeah. Anyway, see you guys later.
Yeah, thanks for calling in and filling us in on this.
Take care. Everybody, callers, call them in and inundate them with phone calls and try to convert them.
Okay. Yeah, but we only have 18 minutes left, so do it quick.
Do it fast. Yeah.
Okay, so long.
Thanks, Carl.
Bye.
Well, yeah, makes a good controversy point. Right here in southern Pennsylvania.
Yeah. And it seems like no matter where you go, there's always someone that is trying to get away with something.
Push the envelope. Yeah.
Brinkmanship.
You think they would have learned from the Dover situation. Dover ended up paying a lot of money, didn't they, for their folly.
And also, it kind of did make them look like a fool, nationwide.
Yes, well, worldwide.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I've seen statistics lately about American students ranking very low in math and science. They used to be number one, now they're, 15th or 17th or something.
Yeah.
And we don't need to take away classroom time. This was going to be done at 8:50, which is class time. They need all the time in class they can get.
Yeah.
They don't need to be outside praying. They can pray on their own. They go home or pray before they get to school.
So if they did it at 8:40, what are they going to do if they're in the middle of a prayer and this little Lord, cut, okay, everyone in the school at 8:50.
I guess that, well, they're going to time it, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, as far as sending a note home, I wonder how many kids just said, I got a note was sent home. Oh, my goodness, this is trouble. Because usually when I got a note sent home from my teachers, it was no good news, you know.
Yeah.
It was not something that was good was going to come of that. So I wonder how many of them just took that note and threw it away.
But it's exactly opposite.
Yes,
from
what it should be. Right.
You know, would you like your child to participate in the prayer?
Yes.
Give the authorization of the thing. And if we don't hear from you, then we won't ask him to come to the maypole. Yeah. I mean the flagpole.
The flagpole. Yeah. Whatever. Yeah. Well,
it's a September pole.
Whatever it is, yeah. Well, there's some interesting things going on in government. Here's a story that we picked up in the paper. Doug, you've picked this up also.
Yeah.
Let me read this here. Authorities say nonviolent offenders in southern Alabama will have a new choice, go to jail or go to church every Sunday for a year. Now, this is called Operation Restore Our Community. It's from Bay Minette, Alabama. The city judge in Bay Minette will let misdemeanor offenders choose to work off their sentences in jail and pay a fine or go to church every Sunday for a year. If offenders select church, they'll be allowed to pick the place of worship but must check in weekly with the pastor and police. And if the one-year church attendance program is completed, the offender's case will be dismissed. Now, I find that interesting.
Isn't
that wonderful? You go to church for like an hour a week.
Yeah.
The other 167 hours, you're out there doing whatever it was you got in trouble with, I guess.
Yeah, you just embezzled some money.
Yeah.
Okay, that's nonviolence.
Yeah.
Here, well, I don't choose to go to church. And
you go to jail.
So now I've got to church. But all I have to do is just pretend.
Yep, that's right. Well, I've always felt I've dealt with people got arrested for drugs.
Yeah.
And before they go to trial, they entered a rehab program. They entered a drug program. Well, they didn't enter a drug program seriously. They entered it because they want to get their sentence reduced.
Yeah.
You're not serious about getting off drugs.
Everyone in jail finds Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it looks like they hung up.
No, 9-1, got somebody here?
I think so.
Okay. There you go.
Caller, you still there?
Yes.
Good.
Do you have a question or a comment?
Yeah, I'm a black atheist, African American.
Oh, congratulations.
And, I have a friend who's a Christian, and I read several years ago that I read where Christianity was one of the reasons that the slave trade started in West Africa. How the Portuguese went down there, and in the name of Jesus, they introduced the Bible to West Africans.
Mm-hmm.
And the first ship to leave out of West Africa was called the slave ship Jesus.
Oh.
So I'm telling I'm saying to him, why should you all of a sudden worship Jesus when he was used to enslave our people? And what I'm asking you, I guess, do you think that he should worship Jesus?
No. I mean, I agree with you. There were a lot of
Slavery was approved. I mean, God says
Bible.
You may have slaves.
Yeah.
You know, just you know, not of your own family or
he
kind.
He says from your neighboring countries, right?
Yeah.
So
slavery was got the official approval by God in the Bible, that. And so now in today's society, we turn around and say, well, God, that isn't really such a good idea that you had here, because even us, you know, lowly mortals, us sinners, realize that slavery is wrong.
Well, so, a lot of Christians, of course, are cafeteria Christians. They pick and choose the parts of the Bible they want to listen to, and that's
exactly
one they kind of ignore.
And, I said it.
You still there?
Yeah, and I say the same thing to my Muslim friends too. You know, Muslims went in there and enslaved Africans also.
Yes.
Yeah, and anyone who comes into your home and enslaves you in the name of any god, that god can't be any use to you.
No.
Because the god that was used to enslave you, not be used to free you.
Yes. I agree, and I mean, let's face it, that is what the mystique, what the whole idea of Jesus was supposed to be about. When the Jews predicted the King of the Jews, this great King, would come forth and deliver them from slavery. Jesus came, but slavery certainly wasn't abolished in his time.
Jesus said he didn't come for peace. Jesus said, do not think I came for peace. I came with a sword.
Yeah.
And I tell my friends, I said, if you do the history on Jesus, every place he went, hell and destruction soon followed. There was no place safe. You know, he went into Africa, hell and destruction followed. He came to America, hell and destruction followed. Christopher Columbus came over with a cross, and 20 million Native Americans was destroyed within 20 years.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were the original terrorists, weren't we? We came over here and took their land.
Yeah.
Well, it was some Europeans that really did come in peace. But it was those, I call them Christians. Came over here with ulterior motives.
Yeah, they believe in. Yeah, look at the Inquisition in Spain. You know.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Well, caller, do you live in York?
Yes, I do.
Well, if you're interested in meeting some other atheists, I'll get a plug for our organization, Pennsylvania Nonbelievers. We meet the first Saturday every month, which will be this Saturday coming up, from 10 to 2 at the Unitarian Universalist Congregation on South George Street.
That's 10 to midnight. Down 10 to noon.
10 till noon, not midnight.
Yeah.
We're not late. We're not late people. But we're in the carriage house in the back. If you want to meet some friendly atheists, feel free to stop down.
You guys are not terrorized or scorned by Christians in the community?
Well, some do, but some... Yeah. You know, I'll tell you what I've generally found. When we go to street fairs and things, like you see it's at the Mother's Day Fair, there's an inverse relationship between the level of anger and the intelligence. The intelligent Christians understand that we have our point of view, we don't agree with them, and they, you know, they sometimes come over and talk to us and argue a little bit, but it's the people that I think are lesser intelligence who really get upset at us and really are upset that we're there and want to argue and yell at us. And I don't know what they think they're accomplishing, because they're not going to change our mind, and we're not going to change their mind, but they get all upset about it.
Yeah, and the I can't tell you the number of times that we've all been assured that we are going to hell. And it's like, yeah, after you.
Yeah, I get that all the time,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, okay, well, hey, I'll pay a visit. That's Unitarian down on South George Street, right?
Yes, in the carriage house behind the main chapel there.
You have to walk down the stairs, the steps, and watch the steps if there's any leaves on the thing.
Don't get a bad experience.
Oh, yeah, I fell down those steps. So grab the hand.
So be careful, yes.
Yeah.
But we hope to see you then.
Nice talking to you guys.
Nice talking
likewise.
To you. Thanks for calling. Have a good night.
You too.
Yeah, some people get upset at us, don't they?
Yeah. And the strange thing is that they don't want to discuss anything. All they want to do is condemn. And just by the words in their own Bible,
right,
them condemning us automatically condemns them to hell.
Yeah. Well, we've also had people who use the Bible to try to convert us,
yeah,
and as many times as we try to explain to them, we don't believe the Bible's historically accurate.
Yeah.
We believe it was written by men. It wasn't written by a supreme being. It was written by men, and many of the stories in there were stories that were handed down, you know, before the written word was really around, and
mm-hmm,
and we all know it. If you the old party trick where you take a story and pass it around the room, what it ends up with, well, you can only imagine after hundreds or thousands of years, stories being handed out, what they turn out to be.
Yeah.
You know, people living inside a fish. Well, that's you know, that's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
That
didn't or happen. Talking snake.
Yeah,
yeah.
Or some of the people I hear talking, I think, are snakes.
We've run into a few of those.
They're not physically snakes. So, you know, that we're exaggerating there. But yeah, but people that want to convert us with the Bible, I mean, it's hard to get through to some of them that, no, we don't believe the Bible. Just because it says something in there doesn't mean we accept it as true.
Yeah, I personally think that it's about the same as me believing in, you're reading the novels Harry Potter, and believing in wizards and magic wands and everything like that, and getting on my broom stick 3000 model, you know, and flying off into the sky. They're all fairy tales. It's all fiction. And then they come out and say, yes, but it says in the Bible that you... And it's like, who cares what it says in the Bible? Find me some other source that will corroborate what it says in the Bible. Give me some supporting evidence, and I'll be only too pleased to listen to what you have to say like that. And what can I say? Did you have another thing there that you wanted to...
That was something we were going to talk about after the show.
But you know, let's get back up, because we still got about 5 minutes.
Alabama.
Here. Yeah, Alabama.
So if you go to church for every Sunday for a year, you won't have to go to jail, and then you can go back, I guess, to doing whatever you were doing if you don't get caught, you know?
I wonder if they sort of expunge your record.
It doesn't say anything about that.
Yeah.
Now, I think you were telling me some other groups, the ACLU...
The ACLU, according to another report of this, which I read, I think it was... maybe CNN.com, there was saying that the ACLU has complained to these people that it really is blurring the wall between church and state.
Separation of church and state, yes.
Yeah.
That's another interesting topic. You hear so many people say, that's not in the Constitution. The wall... Well, neither is are the words Christian nation, but yet they insist we are a Christian nation. We're a secular nation. And I think Thomas Jefferson coined the phrase wall of separation.
Yeah.
And I've heard other people, I forget exactly, some religious leaders, one of them claimed that this came from Karl Marx, mm-hmm. which Jefferson wrote his letter in 1812, I believe it was, to the Danbury Church. Well, that's before Karl Marx mm-hmm. wrote his treatise. Another preacher claims an idea from Hitler. Well, now, Thomas Jefferson and Hitler did not live at the same time, unless maybe you believe, I don't know, maybe Michelle Bachmann believes it, I don't know. You know, maybe she thinks that's true.
Yeah.
But, Thomas Jefferson hardly copied from Hitler, since he lived, you know, 100 some years before him.
But isn't it convenient, if you want to demonize someone, you know, Hitler was an atheist. No, he wasn't. He was a Roman Catholic. Okay. Well, Lenin. Stalin.
They were atheists.
Like that. Yeah, but you know, they originally were religious people. I think both of them were Catholic at one time.
And you know, for one thing, I would never claim that all atheists are good people. Atheists are no different than any other group. You have good and bad in any kind of any group you want to name. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, look at Catholic priests. We've seen a few examples of they are not exactly worthy of adoration. So I'm one, like I said, does not want to claim that, oh, we're all good, all atheists are good, they all do the right thing. No, they don't. People like Stalin and Lenin were not very good people. But that had nothing to do with the fact that they were atheists. It had to do with they were megalomaniacs.
Yeah, and they were rotten to begin with.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I heard that Stalin, you know, died of a heart attack, and that one reason he died was in the Kremlin, he would sleep in a different bedroom every night because he was paranoid about people trying to, and they didn't know where he was, and when he didn't wake up, they didn't know where to go get him. They finally found him, and poor guy had a heart attack and that. Well, not poor guy. Good thing he's gone. But
there's always evil people out there. There's evil Jews. Well, one just called in.
Some people think he's evil.
Yeah. So, well, some people, not everyone. I don't think he's evil.
Some atheists think he's evil.
you've got the evil Muslims. You've got the evil Christians. I mean, no matter what religion. I mean, you can strip away the religion like that, and then just say there are evil people. Some happen to be Muslim, some happen to be Jewish, some happen to be Christian, like that. But I think it's the people that use religion as an excuse.
Right.
My God wants me to punish you, or my God says that I should kill you.
Right.
I should take your land, and I can take your wives, and I can kill your kids, do it. Well, excuse me, I wasn't in on that conversation.
Yeah. How many times do we hear people say, he's a good Christian gentleman? Like, what does that mean?
Yeah,
if he's a good gentleman, he's a good gentleman. He's not. Yeah, and Doug, I think you made the point before that if you took 50 people and put them in a room, atheists and Christians and Muslims, and you said, talk about any subject except religion, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference.
No. No, you've got the all the same. Well, it looks like that we are winding down here to the last 45 seconds. We would very much like it if you would tune in again in 2 weeks, because we will be here gracing your airwaves again. Well, I don't know about grace. That's kind of amazing there. But we should be back again. And one of the evil atheists will be on the show here trying to spread the word of atheism there. Just remember one thing, that there are more atheists than all the Jews, all the Amish, and all the Mennonites put together. So you have a good night. Good night, George.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
And we'll see you.